What is up? Welcome back to the channel. So in this video, I am interviewing Maria Lamardo. I clearly didn't pronounce that the right way, but she'll correct me at the first question of the interview. So this series of videos is done in collaboration with the Vue.js Global event. This is from the same organizers as the excellent Vue.js Amsterdam conference. So we are collaborating. So I am basically interviewing a bunch of the speakers. We talk about their talk a bit technically. And then after that, I ask the questions that I want to ask the speakers myself. So this way, I get to do really cool interviews with great people. And the conference organizers can like cut out a little part. And that's a nice promotional material about the talks that the speakers give. So in this interview, as I said, I'm talking to Maria. We talk about her unconventional path into tech. We talk about her talk that is all about accessibility and forms, which is generally quite complex. And it's a great conversation. It moved very fast. I didn't realize we already spent 25 minutes on it when we were done. So without further ado, this is the interview with Maria Lamardo. Welcome, Maria. How are you?
Good. How are you?
All good. Thanks so much for joining me here in this conference and slash interview talk. I'm super happy to have you. So your name doesn't sound American, or maybe a little. Can you tell me how to pronounce it, first of all, because I've probably not said it properly in our introduction, and also talk about where it comes from?
Sure. So my name is Maria Lamardo. I am originally from Venezuela, though I do have Italian descent. So that's actually where my last name is from.
Ah, there you go. And were you born in the US?
No, I was born in Venezuela. And then I came to the US in 2001.
Okay. And did you have to learn English, or did you just learn that as a child already?
I definitely had to learn English. I think it's funny because growing up, we had like the English classes, and that was like my least favorite class. I remember when my parents told us we were moving to the US, I'm like, no, now I cannot escape it. I have to
learn English. Oh, no, you have to go English. Great. Well, you sound very American to me. Then again, I'm from Europe, so a lot of English sounds good to me. So let's talk about the conference, because we're doing this interview in context of the Vue.js Global Conference. So can you talk about like your talk and what it's about?
Yeah, so I'm going to be going over accessible forms. So how to create forms in an accessible way so that all your users can go and fill out the forms, especially users who are using assistive technology like keyboard and screen readers and things like that, to be able to navigate and fill out your forms.
Wow, it sounds like a small topic, but I think it's actually pretty big because there's a lot of ways you can use forms, right?
Yeah, especially for like the advanced forms, it can get pretty complicated.
So what to you is an advanced form?
Things that are kind of conditional, or things that are required if another field has already been filled out and is required. So making sure that the focus management is handled correctly there, that the design also supports accessibility features and things like that. So yeah.
Okay, so if you had to do like a little elevator pitch, like this is a CFP, right? Generally, you say, okay, this is the talk what you just did. But what will the audience learn when they see your talk?
Well, you definitely want all your users to be able to fill out the form, especially if it's an important, crucial form to your application, like trying to sign up, right, create an account. So just making sure that all your users can go through it and actually submit the form the way that you intended for your applications to be used. So like if you're not considering accessibility in your forms, you're going to be missing out in a lot of users who are just not going to be able to navigate your form. And I think it's 1 billion people around the world have some sort of disability. That's 15% of the entire world population. And Whoa. They account for, yeah, it's a huge number.
Yes.
And then people with disabilities and their families account for, they have a spending power of $6 trillion. So again, it's a big, big number and a lot of companies should care about. So if you're building an application that has forms, please consider how keyboard kind of plays into this.
Yeah, exactly. And how do you consider people that have really slow devices or almost no internet? you have to able to click that buy button or to right. do a checkout, right? So are you taking care of that in your talk as well? It's like maybe no JavaScript or it hasn't loaded yet and these kind of things?
Oh, I wasn't thinking about doing that, but I will definitely add it after this conversation. Thanks.
Oh, there you go. Because I see that pretty often. Like I always say to my team is like, okay, build it for no JavaScript. And they're like, yeah, but everybody has JavaScript. And right. then I always say they don't have JavaScript until they have it, right? Especially with those new React bundles that are huge and it has right. to hydrate and all of that stuff. What if it hasn't hydrated yet and you have to click that button? Nothing mm-hmm. happens. It's a very sad form, right?
Yeah, luckily, I feel like a lot of accessibility issues inside forms are handled by the correct use of the semantic elements, right? So like a lot of it is HTML heavy, I would say. I think like if you're using the correct element for the job, you are going to be able to have a better experience for those users without JavaScript.
Yeah, exactly. And how do you intend to handle error messages? Because I know some people might be colorblind, and if you put a red box around the input, they haven't seen that. So how do you right. deal with that?
Yeah, so there's a couple of things. Like you can use styling like that, like the red border, and maybe like give it a hint of red like inside the input. But then you definitely want to create like the error messages right underneath each input field that has the error. And then if a user is trying to submit the form, say that the second field or something has an error, as soon as you submit the form, you want to call focus back into that specific input so that the user can see the error message, especially users who are using like screen magnification tools. They're able to clearly see what is being asked of them to kind of fix.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. This is always what's hard. And oh, I have so many annoying questions for you. How about I am on my iPhone, right? And you kind of often have it on an iPhone that the menu bar pops open like that. If you, or your keyboard, I mean. And then your field might be in focus, but it didn't want to zoom, or it's still a desktop website. Like, how do you deal with that kind of stuff? Is there any way to deal with that?
Well, I would say just making sure that your input fields are correct semantically would take care of a lot of this. So making sure that you're using like inputs and then the type of input that you have, it should kind of take care of that scrolling behavior.
Yeah, exactly. And what is your opinion on, you kind of see it often nowadays that a password field has a little eye icon on the side. So when you click that, you can see your password. And then generally, they don't have two passwords field anymore to validate that you actually typed in the right password. What do you think about this stuff? Is it actually accessible?
So there are a lot of things about password. And I think I talk to clients a lot about like where they have to even write out the requirements for the password. So sometimes you'll see like a little icon that you have to pop open so that you could see all the requirements. But then you have to like remember all of these requirements before you kind of put them in. So a couple of things about password, just like making sure that you're able to see all of the requirements and even provide like a UI like check as you meet each of those requirements so that it's a lot easier to keep track of. And I really like having two different confirming password fields, I guess. That way you can kind of see even the length of the password and things like that, that they're the same.
Yeah, exactly. It's pretty important. Okay, so I won't not ask anymore because I'm assuming you're going to do all of that in your talk and we want people to actually see your talk, right? So how about we dive in? Because, well, I know you a little bit, but not all the viewers do. And I know that your path into technology or into being a developer was, I would say, quite unique. Not to me personally, but that's another story. But would you mind explaining a little bit what happened and how you got into it? And then after that, like, how did you get so good at what you do? Like, I'm really impressed by that. But let's first start with the base story, if you wouldn't mind.
Sure, thanks. Before I started my path into development, right, I am still a board certified assistant behavior analyst. So what that means is I used to provide behavioral therapy for people with developmental disabilities. And it's something that I like just love so much. It was like such a passion and it was such a fulfilling field just to be able to like interact with people one-on-one and like see the difference that you were having in people's lives and like entire families, right? And then about 3 years ago, I got really, really sick. All of a sudden, I had never had really too many issues with health before. And then it pretty much hit me within like 3 weeks. I was kind of in bed, right? Like I couldn't get out of bed. And it was like a rare autoimmune disease that attacked my muscles, my joints, everything. Nobody could really figure it out. So, you know, kind of jumping from specialist to specialist, it was really, really scary. And of course, I had to kind of take medical leave from my work. I was having a hard time just moving. And my husband is a backend developer. And he was, you know, very like, hey, you know what you could do from bed? Like, we didn't know how this was going to kind of work out. So then he really encouraged me to try to learn how to program, because he's like, that's definitely something you could do remotely if you just cannot leave the house. Luckily, As I started, I really, really enjoyed it. I really liked the problem solving aspect of it. But I still felt like it was missing that fulfillment part that I was getting in my previous career. And it wasn't until I was taking a Udacity scholarship course, and then they had a section on accessibility. And I remember like I saw that and I was like, oh my gosh, that's like exactly what I was looking for. Like it's kind of bringing my previous passion into this field and like being able to find that fulfillment in like helping people like have better experiences, right? And that's something that I saw in my previous field that's like, as we struggled finding not only devices that were accessible, but then the applications within those devices had to also function in a certain way. And they just didn't. And it was like a source of frustration, not only for the individual, but for the families that had a hard time communicating, right? So I feel very lucky to have found this, and that I found kind of like a second passion that is also very fulfilling for me.
Yeah, wow, what a story. And so it kind of in a short time turned your life completely around. I can imagine you were quite scared, but like what just happened to me and I need to get out of this. And it's crazy. And what strikes me on this also is like, so before you were kind of in the helping people sphere, and what I've learned, and I'm actually quite similar to you. I used to be a nurse and now I do tech stuff. But there's not that many people that have a technical brain while they do that other type of work. And so for some reason, you just took this Udemy class and you had your husband and you were actually able to snap into that and do that work. So how was that feeling for you to learn like that?
I have always been a pretty big nerd. I've always loved studying. I've always loved taking tests. Like my first class in college was like multivariable calculus just for fun. I didn't even need it to graduate or anything. So I've always just like really enjoyed problem solving. I've really enjoyed like just studying for the hell of it. Like to me, like the most relaxing like environment is like quiet. I'm about to take a test. Oh, wow. So like learning for me, that was like super fun. I had so many notes. Like I just love taking notes, taking classes. So for me, it was like really, really fun. Of course, it wasn't something that I was pushed to until I got sick. I felt like my previous field was also challenging in different ways, and there were a lot of problems to solve. They were just kind of different.
Wow, that's just awesome. And the fact that you just pulled through that and made such a successful career now in such a short time, because I've been like, I'm a dinosaur in this industry and I'm slowly ramping up, and you're like doing this for like 3 years. So if you look at like your Twitter feed and the amount of conferences you speak at, but also just normal work, that's pretty busy, right? And on the other side, you're also still having some health issues. So what is your secret to be able to deal with all of that? To me, you're just a badass, but there might be more, right? And do you have anything about that?
Well, first, I appreciate you saying that. Well, yes, I do maintain a very, very busy life. And it's, you know, I really enjoy it. It's not something that it's a drag, right? Like I just really enjoy doing this work. Therefore, I do it. So at work, I'll put in my hours at work. Then I finish that. Then I do like my community organizing and things like that. I'm working on the accessibility docs for Vue.3 as well, which has been awesome. Like just kind of being able to deep dive more into accessibility. I absolutely love that. But I maintain a very busy schedule. I've recently, since the pandemic, started working out, which is something that I haven't been able to do in about 3 years, actually. And I'm really excited. Luckily, I've been able to kind of keep my symptoms down. But, you know, as you've seen, sometimes they kind of flare up and go away every so often. But luckily, I'm able to kind of maintain a healthy diet and just slowly getting back into working out, which has been amazing.
Oh, this is awesome. So a quick, maybe more complex question, but do you think it's also part of your own mindset that you are sometimes with more issues and sometimes with less? And maybe during the pandemic, you're actually now in a better mindset and do you therefore maybe have less issues and you're able to do sports again, which I can imagine is awesome if you could not do that before.
Yeah, I think that might be true. I remember like when the pandemic hit, I've been so busy before, like especially with traveling and conferences, it's just been like back to back to back. And when the pandemic hit, of course, it was very scary and, you know, it's a bad situation to be in. But some of the positives, I guess, just looking, I always try to look at the positive things as they come out. On this has been, life has slowed down a little bit for me, right? Which has also helped me just kind of focus on my own health a little bit more. Like started working out and things like that, just kind of giving myself some time to get into better habits. And that has absolutely helped me.
So this was a couple of months ago when you were in Amsterdam. We were backstage and it was the second day of the conference and we all went out partying and stuff like that. And I was sitting next to you. We hadn't spoken yet, I think. And you stood up and you had some, it was not the easiest standing up. That's just what it is, right? That's what you have.
Yeah.
And then there's this one guy, I don't remember who it was, but he just joked like, do you have like a big hangover from the party? And then you came back with some quite witty, amazing thing that you said. I don't exactly remember, but do you have to deal with this kind of stuff quite often?
Well, I guess luckily and unluckily, right? Like I have, I guess, like an invisible disease. Like you cannot see it unless I'm like invisible pain sometimes, which is kind of what happened there. And I mean, it doesn't bother me when people make comments like that because I mean, it is really rare, right? And I don't expect people to just automatically go into that mindset of like, oh, wow, she must be really sick or like, you know, that's not as common as like, oh, maybe you partied too much last night. So like, I kind of see that as like, oh, this is an opportunity for me to be able to, hey, let's bring this up. Let's talk about it. Let's show you how like different people might have completely different experiences and they might be going through something that you might not even be able to relate to. So like, yeah, to me, it was like, hey, no, actually, I have this disease, you know, and this is what happens sometimes. And it's more like an opportunity to like educate someone and like just show them different things, right? Like just different experiences from people.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, to me, it almost seems like it enriches your life because you're able now to explain and also give people a different viewpoint of whatever they normally do, right? So I think it can be challenging at times, but I think it's also pretty cool that you are now able to do that, right?
Right. And also like people, sorry.
No, go on.
People just have like different things that they're kind of carrying through their life, right? Like different struggles and they might be very internal. So I think it's kind of good to kind of break down those walls a little bit and show a little bit of vulnerability because I think we're all kind of trying to hide a little bit of that. And I think it's refreshing to see not everybody's like full struggle, but little glimpses of it here and there so that it's like, no, you know, like it's not like a perfect life, right? For anybody.
No, exactly. So you have gone through this whole ordeal and you actually came out really well, great career, speaking everywhere. If you had a tip for someone who wanted to switch their fields, maybe not forced the way you did, but maybe they're thinking on it, what would be the thing that you would tell them to do?
I would say don't be afraid to admit that you don't know things and learn from that. So I've also, especially like starting out the way I did and just kind of going really, really fast. I remember seeing like people who were way more advanced than I was. And I would be like, oh, you should come at meetup or like talk at this conference. And they were like, no, I don't know enough. Or like, no, I'm not there yet. But then I kind of was like, well, like, don't be afraid to just kind of put yourself out there. Like, I've been able to do that. And like, I'm not saying I'm like the best person there is about the topics that I speak about, but I kind of put myself out there, and like doing so, I feel like has made me a better developer. Like even when I make mistakes on presentations, like I will learn from that, right? And I'll next time I'll teach it better and like just kind of continue to grow. So that would be my advice. Like, don't be afraid to make mistakes along the way. That will only make you better and learn faster.
Cool. I couldn't agree more. But not everybody is like that, because to us as developers a little bit, it's like failure is just iteration, right? Mm-hmm. So over time you learn more and more. And to me, I always say, especially in my job, is like, yeah, it's just a website about lipstick. Like it's not a heart rate monitor from Philips, right? So we can fail and then just step up and go. Like you do with forms. When I build a form now, I get frustrated. I already feel it, even though it shouldn't be that hard, right? But luckily we have Vue.js and we have you writing some docs, so that's cool. So is there something that you are good at that nobody really knows about outside of your direct family?
Well, I'm really good at crochet and crafting.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so I like to make projects here and there. And I think that's something that I really liked about as I started my career front end, was like making a bunch of little projects that like, if I spend an hour on this, it's going to keep getting better and better and better and like visually change. So I found that very exciting.
For example, the wall behind you, did you do that yourself?
Yes, actually, when we first moved in, I decided like at 12 at night one day, I was like, let's paint this. So we stayed up on like 4 in the morning painting this wall. And I made this little bunny.
Oh, yeah, it's really cute. And so did you basically just put like tape down and then go from there? Nice.
Yeah, we did a lot of tape.
Looks cool. So if you had a billboard that like everybody would see on their way to work, right? Like millions of people, what would you write on it? For them to read?
Something like be the reason why somebody smiles today. I think that's really good. So kind of breaking that, like bring happiness to yourself by like making somebody else happy. I think if we just kind of keep passing that forward, I think society would be better as a whole.
Oh, wow. It's actually true. I think there's a bunch of research on people who are the most happy is actually the people that help others. Like you can be as rich as you want, but if you're alone, if you don't have a purpose like that, right? So yeah, that's actually pretty profound. And I look at that myself a little bit too, because my wife actually has very similar things to you. It's not the same, but it's close. Right. And I always have people like, okay, so I am the other, I'm like your husband. I live next to it. And like, how does that work? And actually what I tell them is like, my life is not worse by this. I actually have the chance to care for someone. And a lot of people don't have that chance to actually be there for someone. And it makes her stronger, but me for sure also. So what you're saying, actually, it resonates with me. So that's great. Last question, a little lighter. So I know you go to a lot of conferences, right? So what do you do with all the stickers?
So I actually gather way more stickers than I need for my own personal use. And then I do run a couple of local meetups in my area. So I'm always like just passing out any swag that I can get from any conferences.
Okay. So you pass them around. Yeah. I tend to do the same. Like in Vue.js Amsterdam, actually, I think I took like 20 Nuxt stickers and I gave them to everybody who works on Nuxt. So at least I have the feeling, because I want everybody to go there, but it's not always possible. So you give stickers. Right. Yeah, exactly. So we're keeping it relatively short. Well, 25 minutes, not that short, but I want to thank you for opening up like this and showing your story. And I think if you can do that, people that have less issues can definitely do it. There's a chance for everybody as long as you just persevere. So that's great. Thanks for sharing your story.
Thank you so much, Tim. It was great talking to you.
I actually hope to see you soon. I really wish I could travel again, but I cannot come to the US just yet.
I know. Soon we will see each other again.
I have a plan to go to New York. There's a bunch of friends there, and then maybe I can just move around and see some people. All right. So thank you very much. And I hope to see you soon. Cheers.
All right. You too. Bye.